Clayton, in the aftermath of KubeCon, Cloud NativeCon, Europe, there's been a lot of developments. I'm looking forward to have the opportunity to talk through some of the developments with you.
It's a pleasure to talk to you as well. It's been interesting going through the life cycle of Kubernetes from the very earliest. I was one of the early contributors to Kubernetes, and there was a lot of excitement as you capitalize on containers, and containers themselves were really exciting because they're just way faster than VMs. And really, that's all that mattered to that early crowd. And you went through this cycle of, what are the patterns and principles that we want to build on? One of the really interesting things, there's always been a strong thread to, as people make more bets on Kubernetes, as more vendors get involved, as people pivot their strategies, or it becomes a question that you get asked, well, what is your container strategy? Or, how are you approaching hybrid cloud? Or how are you going to deal with multi-cloud? It's been interesting how some of these themes have really emerged of, you can't overlook the little details. You have to stay really focused on what you're getting out of Kubernetes. And I think the most successful organizations I've seen, have been, whether they were big complex tech companies getting on really early, or whether they're maybe more conservative organizations that are still trying to do big consolidation, they've all had that theme of, if the ecosystem isn't there yet, you have to have a technology approach that can solve that problem for you. And I've noticed that same principle, I think, is that it's getting to a point where most of the options and most of the things that you need can still be found and integrated. And the question is are you ready for that transition? Are you ready to do that integration yourself? Do you have the right skills to make that possible?
I heard an interview with Joe Beta, one of the founders, of course, of Kubernetes, saying that this was by design. We wanted to be as minimal as possible and deliver the core of what we needed to be done to prove out capability of technology, with the expectation that the community was going to provide this over time. And it seems to me that, where we are on a scale of 1 to 10, it's hard to say. If we cross the halfway mark, it's hard to say. But I believe that enterprises that are eager to take advantage of some of this new technology, I'm hearing them starting to move towards production. And they're coming up on these various considerations that mainstream applications require. This storage, data recovery, resiliency, and so forth. The ability to stand up to audit, security seem to be other critical capabilities that Kubernetes, however it's consumed, is going to have to provide.
And, it's an interesting way of describing it, because a lot of the early mindset was understanding what is achievable and what a community can achieve and what an ecosystem needs to achieve. Mm-hmm. And Kubernetes was very minimal and still is today in a sense. It's a place where those abstractions can sort themselves out, but someone has to commit to it. And I think this is really the role of over time, increasingly, there's a lot of things in the stack that aren't Kubernetes that have to work well together. There's a lot of, I think, implicit standardization people believe Kubernetes provides. And in my experience, it really is up to the distributions and the vendors to try to find some set of technology that works, that's supportable over the long run. One of the things that I want to see Kubernetes as an ecosystem do is I want to see more opportunities for standardization to fill in those gaps. And for people to be able to have that expectation that, yeah, it works consistently. Today, that tends to be a one or two vendor kind of approach. And there's definitely a lot more that can be done. And I think most people have an incentive to see that happen, because for every organization working with a vendor on Kubernetes plus what's around it, there are tens or hundreds, is maybe an exaggeration, of people who are building it themselves and are going to get burned at some point, whether that's life cycle skills or the stuff we mentioned before. The realities of change in an open ecosystem are, there's a lot of pace that you have to keep up with, and it's easy to fall behind.
Even the most ardent Kubernetes supporters would acknowledge that it is complex. The counter is that it's worth it, that the dynamism that comes with this way of working, this organization, it harmonizes mainstream IT with the scale and productivity that's been seen in the big cloud providers for some time. That seems true at the highest level, but there's still going to be a gap between acknowledging that and making that actually operational in real time. You've got corporations today that still are running very important, you know, CICS systems, you know, from IBM, you know, transactional applications. You've got people running networks that are not easily adapted to the cloud in any kind of scalable way. You've got people with substantial ERP type implementations, which don't seem to be moving anytime soon. So I think really the challenge for the Kubernetes community is to find a way to have something meaningful to say across this, to say whether it's going to be addressed in the near term or whether it's going to be addressed over time. What is the story about how to get there? Because I think it's easy for people to kind of squint and see 5 years down the line and see what the transformation might look like. But the navigating from here to there is quite complex.
One of the interesting things that I think led to Kubernetes was, you know, in the mid-2000s leading into the first half of the 2010s, that effort around platform as a service, looking to standardize application deployment, application rollout, application lifecycle, many organizations, many of the large successful organizations had approaches already to deal with some of this, whether that's large-scale Linux, technology has been around for a while, LDAP and Kerberos provided standard workload identity across big fleets. I feel it was Kubernetes is kind of in the Goldilocks zone, which is it's neither too hot nor too cold. It's neither too big nor too small. Everybody can look at it and see a big chunk of win. And just having one or a few approaches really is what it doesn't have to be the best technology. It just has to be a technology that everybody works together on, which like Linux smooths out that. You can find a big pool of people who are reasonably familiar versus seeing it balkanized into 10 or 20 different approaches. So I think Kubernetes needs to keep bringing in ideas, but I do think we're kind of at that point of Kubernetes starting to, as we look at the second stage, a lot of the concepts work really well, but some of the abstractions and some of the stuff are maybe too detailed. Most organizations that I know of who are deploying Kubernetes are building layers on top of Kubernetes. Whether that's a CI/CD layer, whether that's an existing layer. So some of the large organizations that already have these technologies fit Kubernetes into their existing application lifecycle, many of which are very sophisticated, very mature. And that layer on top of Kubernetes, I think, is actually a really interesting area where Kubernetes wasn't intended to really be too specific to a particular set of machines. But in practice today, if you choose one vendor's service and then try to run it on a different vendor's services, not all the APIs are the same. So I think Kubernetes will kind of evolve both as an ecosystem and as an ecosystem on top of Kubernetes so that you'll start to see some of that convergence. And then I do think new technologies have to be integrated. This is the, more than anything else, we're not going to stop inventing new ideas, new ways of packaging software. Serverless is a great example. I don't even think we've really scratched the surface of what it means to bring small amounts of code into close contact with data and services and enterprise IT. And so that transformation probably won't work exactly as another component in Kubernetes, but could absolutely be part of that ecosystem and drive some requirements around multi-cluster consolidation of workloads. What happens when you want to move a workload between clouds? What happens when you want to keep dependencies and bring your workloads close to where your data lives? Because data gravity is a very real organizational force that will shape, how people deploy and how people adopt cloud.
Clay, one thing I noticed about the CNCF case studies, there are 88 last I looked, almost all of them are technology companies. SaaS providers or online commerce or big banks. We talked about CERN as a special case. I think the community could do a lot better at illustrating where Kubernetes can work in production for companies that are not born in the cloud, that are not internet created, but actually have been around for some time and kind of do day-to-day work, whether it's manufacturing, insurance, finance, name it.
The boring stories, because I think Kelsey's right, is What's boring is things just working and you make reasonable choices and you're conservative in your approach and you have a good relationship with a community and one or more vendors. And when those stories get told, they're usually, I modernized my infrastructure, or I was able to accomplish this modest project, or I reduced my costs. I agree. I think we often focus on the cool part in the ecosystem. And many of the vendors, from the players that have been around the whole time in Kubernetes to the public clouds bringing managed services to integrators and others, have a lot of those success stories that come from making the right choice. I don't know if there's a lesson, but if you see a giant tech company picking open source software, they may tell you where the wind's blowing, but you really need to look at the folks who are successful, not just building it themselves, to really assess. And I do think that's something the community can do a lot better.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that's the key for people to really better understand how Kubernetes is going to develop and change IT in ways that are immediately beneficial and meaningful for them. But hey, it's been a great conversation. I look forward to following up at some point. Great conversation. Glad to have the opportunity to chat.
Lee, it's been phenomenal talking to you. I really enjoy this this perspective, and how do we as the larger ecosystem of everybody, we're all trying to improve, to give the right information at the right time, from community to vendor to analyst. And I think that this flow is something that even the ecosystem doesn't do enough of. And so it was a really pleasure to talk to you today. Thank you.
Thank you.